Welcome to the Wednesday, October 5th, 2016, meeting of the Community Preservation Committee. As always, we begin with general public comment. As there is no general public, we will move on. Before we do approval of minutes, just a quick chair's report, if I may. The first is to introduce the newest member of our committee, Ann Brooks. Ann comes to us with glowing recommendations from... From Devin Bruce. Devin is the chair of the planning board and regretfully is resigning from our committee because of work obligations that would take her away from a lot of the meetings because of her obligations as chair and some increased work obligations with some of the transportation stuff.
And you must make wise and pithy comments.
Yes.
You are filling. Yes, is that what you're saying?
Very large.
And also peppermint lifesavers.
She's the peppermint lifesaver lady. There's no doubt about that.
Yes, we do. We will miss Devin in many ways, mainly for her wisdom and intelligence, but also for the fact that she supplies us with candy.
She supplies the planning board too.
Ann will not be voting with us on this meeting until her appointment. She is unable to do that. David, Ann is now the planning board rep. One of our elected representatives. So Ann is kind enough to sit through this meeting and hopefully not the next one without voting. Hopefully her appointment will move or sail through city council or however it sails through. So welcome, Ann. If you need, I know that Devin met with you and went through a bunch of the stuff, the other projects before you. So if there's anything any of us can do to help you navigate this, please let us know. We have one new member who will be arriving in just a few minutes who's new to the committee as well. So you're not alone in your newness. A couple other things for the chair's report. One is there were three of us who went to the unveiling of the Coolidge clock, whatever it's called, which was Seth Thomas clock, which was a week ago, was it? Something like that. So that was fun, and the mayor made some comments and thanked us for our work, the committee work. So it was nice to see 20 people there, maybe. Is that right?
Beautiful.
Yeah, something like that.
It's really beautiful.
Yeah, CPA are good.
And then it was this last Monday that work began on phase two of Pulaski. So we saw some tree cutting being done, it's fenced off, so it's nice to know that work is beginning. For those of you that didn't read the email, a week from Friday, October 14th at 4 o'clock, Sarah, is the grand opening of the Connecticut River Greenway River Access. So. For those of you that haven't been there, it would be nice to go there because we are funding another round, or we are slated to fund another round of that. So it would be nice. It would be nice to be there. So that is the 14th at 4 o'clock. And I believe that's it for my chair's report. So we'll go back. Is there a motion to approve the minutes of September 21st? Is there a second?
Sure.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Usually we do discussion. Any discussion? Sorry.
I was not here for that meeting, but it looked like there was an incomplete thought at one point in there.
How dare you suggest any of us would ever have incomplete thoughts? Strike that from the minutes.
Incomplete recording of the thought.
Okay, thank you.
No, that's probably pretty accurate.
Or maybe my thought was incomplete. Let's see if I can get myself to it. It was Sarah's on the second page.
There's a typo also in there.
Yeah. Where it says, in the section above where it says other business not foreseen, it says,
oh, yes.
Jeff asked if the CPC should require that.
Okay. So and then that was a thought about the master plan for historic campaign. So So that whether the CPC should require that that plan be provided.
Thank you for noticing that, Linda. So we're proving with that incomplete sentence now more or less completed, correct? Any other discussion on that? Okay, moving right along. We had asked that the Academy of Music provide us with additional plans so that Sarah would go ahead and release the money that has already been spent on the historic Tuttle curtain. Deborah did so in one of the attachments that Sarah sent us yesterday. I don't know if folks had a chance to quickly look at that. It reveals, in my opinion, nothing new to us. It is simply a restating of the old one. I think it's pretty much exactly what the old one was. Nonetheless, we do need a motion to release money to the Academy of Music to pay off their outstanding bills for the Tuttle curtain, given that she did do what we asked, which was to provide this. So if we can have a motion, then we can discuss it if we need to.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, discussion?
Difficult when the money has already been spent. Sarah, what kind of discussion was there? Because it is really pretty much the same.
There's an additional sentence, right, about cooperation with, I think, Smith?
Yeah, it was College Theater, I don't think was there.
Yeah, that was about it. I mean, I recounted to the Academy the discussion that was held here, but they were having a hard time coming up with anything else that they would be able to do.
Well, I guess if it's been mined as much as it can be, these are limitations. And I approve it.
Jeff, and Jeff? Ann is a new member from the planning board, and Jeff is with us from Cosmos. Any additional discussion regarding the Academy's plans?
I feel like they're just being honest with us that they can't set a schedule out there, and they realize, I hope they realize our motivation behind it, but at least they're not promising something they can't deliver. Obviously, they're limited, but it's a reasonable assembly of dates, I thought.
Anybody else want to weigh in? So the motion is to approve funds for the Tuttle curtain, given their management plan, however sparse it may be. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Abstentions? All right, so it is unanimous. Thank you, Deborah, for providing us with that. So at the last meeting, we approved two of our small grants to the Northampton Historic Society. One was for the Gare collection, and the other was for the Pro Rush collection. Once we approve them, Sarah writes up the orders that go to City Council, which is coming up at their next meeting, is that correct?
Yes. They are meeting tomorrow, so this will be October 20th.
October 20th, okay. Let's start with the Gare one. Is there a motion to approve these, what do we call these again?
These are council
orders.
Funding recommendation council.
Funding recommendation for the Garrett collection. Is there a motion to approve this?
So moved.
A second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Let's go. Is there a motion to approve the Pro Brush?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? All right, we are zipping right along here. So if you'll pull out, hopefully you have it in front of you, the sort of what the our fiscal year 2017 financial issues are. And let me do my best just to go through it to the best of my understanding and ask Sarah questions if we need to. For new folks, just to remind you that we are required by law to set aside 10% of the revenue coming into us for historic preservation, for open space acquisition, and for affordable housing, whether we use it or not. So we have expectations of revenues of $1,457,000. And that's still up in the air, is that correct?
That is still up in the air.
Isn't it one also a quarter for recreation?
No. There's not something for recreation. It's three. It's open space acquisition, historic preservation, and affordable housing.
And recreation is in that open space category. But we're not required to set aside any funds for that.
Thank you. So out of the 1.457 million, looking at setting aside 11% just to make sure we don't underfund these, we are putting aside 160,000 for each of those. If we do not spend that money, then it rolls over into the next fiscal year. Remember, our fiscal year is the state fiscal year. We go July 1st through July 1st, and this is round one of that 2017. 17 fiscal year. We could take up to 5% of what our revenues are for administration. It's a little bit less than 5%, but we are estimating somewhere around 60,000 that goes into the city to administer and do all the work that all the good work that Sarah and Wayne, et cetera, do. Knowing that we have bonded heavily, or are still heavily bonded for three projects if you look at the bottom. So even though we have 1.457 million to spend, that is really not discretionary spending on our part. We have a bunch of money going out for Bean Farm, 65 for principal and 15 for interest. So what's that, 80,000? For Florence Fields, 95 plus 36, whatever that may be. And for Pulaski, which is our big bonding, 270 plus 31,000. So if we subtract that from the 1.457 million, we get 917,000, which is what we are able to spend. That includes the 160,000 coming from those three funds that we need to at least put money into. Are there questions about the budget?
A couple. One is, and you may have discussed this last week, so last meeting, so I apologize since I wasn't here. I'm assuming this is only the bonding for phase one of Pulaski?
That is correct. This does not include the most recent award for Pulaski Park.
So I know I kept asking last year, when do we think the bonding will be for Pulaski? So then it was kind of a moving target, but is there any sense of when the phase two?
The project is beginning, that bond will be issued sometime probably within the next 6 months.
Next 6 months?
Yes.
So
that will be finalized and we'll have to begin making principal and interest payments the following fiscal year.
Okay. And that was over 10 years, is that? I'm just trying to get a sense of what.
I think it was seven years.
I thought some of us wanted five, some of us wanted 10.
Yeah, my memory's not clear.
And Sarah, do you remember how? So we will not be expected to allocate money for that until fiscal year 18, is that correct?
That is correct.
So we do not need to factor that into our 917,000. Yeah.
Will there be any accrued interest that will become due the following year?
There may be at that point. We won't know until the bond rates come back.
Thank you for bringing that up.
And the reason that we have to do this now and not wait until all of these numbers are known, including the state match, is because we, for some reason, that no one in the city or state is really sure, these accounts have to be set up so that the city can set its tax rate, even though that this has nothing to do with the tax rate.
I don't understand why we are not releasing money in advance of fiscal year 18.
For the bond payments?
Yeah.
We don't know what the payments get.
Because we don't know what the payments get. Does that answer your question, Linda?
Yeah, but I have another one.
Is everyone clear, though, about the bonding? Yes, any questions about that?
If you could just remind me the amount that we'll be bonding, Sarah?
That
will take a few minutes. Okay. Then let me move on to my next question, which you also have to answer. I get confused. I looked at what was sent out for the financial report, and I think you've answered this before, but I still get confused. I'm looking at the tab that was FY17 overview, and the two things. One, the first subheading says FY16.
And that is incorrect.
That's a typo.
That's a typo.
Okay, and at the bottom it says CPA, of that same column, it says CPA funds available for FY16 round two. It really should say FY16.
Yeah, also a typo.
One.
The numbers are all correct, but we forgot to change the previous one.
In terms of the numbers being correct, I was having a hard time going from that to the revenues of $1,457,000. I just couldn't quite make it match up.
Between the funds available
between the projected budget on this sheet and the $1,457,000 in this transfer order.
So if we add estimated revenue, state match, and free cash, we get less than 1.47, is that what you're saying? We get 1.3, no, we get 1.4, don't we get about 1.47? If we add those top three up, the estimated revenue, 1.14 million, the 300,000 state match, and the free cash will roll over 45,000. What does that come up to?
Yeah.
It's a 1.4 something million, right?
Yeah, so it's the 1.14 plus the 300,000 with an extra 7,000 added.
What is this 45,000 then, looking at that fiscal year 17 overview? The free cash is at 45,000.
The free cash is already hanging out in the budget reserve account, so that's already there. We don't have to move that over.
Okay.
Maybe I just did it wrong, but I got 1,485,000 if you include the free cash.
Sarah's suggesting that we're not.
We don't have to move that over because it's already in the budgeted reserve. So this order just moves the anticipated revenue.
So that's 1,440,000.
Correct.
So I'm sorry, it's not a big point, but shouldn't this reflect?
Shouldn't it be consistent?
Yeah.
Both things be consistent.
It's estimated revenues.
Yeah, the estimated revenue has changed a little bit since our last financial report because we have slightly better state match.
Okay,
estimate.
All right, that's good enough.
And that will be updated on the next financial report.
All right.
So we're sticking with the 1.457 million and the 917,000 for both round one and two. And just, Linda, to be clear, and everyone else, so back to that fiscal year 17 overview, the CPA funds available for fiscal year 17 round one and round two.
Yeah.
Not just round.
Oh, good point.
And we are bonding $675,000 for the next phase of Pulaski Park.
$670,000 total?
The bonding amount is $675,000. The overall project amount was an additional $130,400 that was cash.
And it's 7 years.
Yes.
I'm sorry, it's $670,000 over 7 years?
Yeah, the committee allowed up to 7 years. Sometimes that may change when we go out to bond based on rates that we'll get at that point, but I'll talk to those as we.
So it'll be somewhere around $100,000 in a year. Okay. Linda, any other questions?
No, I'm all set, thank you.
I wonder if you and the chair can refresh my memory. Our status on the phase two of Pulaski Park, we certainly had a long discussion on it. Did we commit to that bond there?
Yes.
Okay,
and as Sarah said, up that's the $670,000 that we committed, and up to 7 years bonding. Is that what you just said?
Yes.
That's the 6.7. Okay.
Yeah, that's the 6.7. Other questions about the funding stuff, fiscal stuff? So as we know, if we add up all the projects that have come into us for this round, they total $912,000, of which we've already spent $6,000 for the two historic Northampton projects. So given the fact that we have revenues at our disposal of $917,000. If in fact we were to fully fund every project, we would have essentially nothing for the second round. So we'll need to keep that in mind as we move through this. Any other questions about this? Good to go? All right, so Sarah did a nice job.
We just need to approve that. A lot of discussion.
Oh, okay. So is there a motion to approve the, what are we calling this?
FY17 financial transfers.
Is there a motion to approve the fiscal year 17 financial transfers?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right. So Sarah has done a nice job in scheduling our first five proposals with one person to speak for them. So Wayne, you are, I say on the hot seat, but if you want to sit, I mean, if this goes on and on.
I have slides, so.
You've got slides. So for those of you that don't know Wayne Fiden, does everyone know Wayne? Do you want to do a quick introduction of yourself one more time?
So I'm Director of Planning and Sustainability for the city. In that hat, we staff the Conservation Commission, which is the principal agency that buys open space and conservation land in the city. We staff the Recreation Department just for buying open space and multi-use trails. And then different people in the city involved in affordable housing, but we're part of the players in doing affordable housing. So a lot of different projects, but they're for different internal clients, if you will, within the city. And every project we do with some partner within the city, typically board. So
thank you, as always, Wayne, for the work that you do and for your presentation tonight. The hope is that we have all read both the proposals as well as the questions that we submitted to you and the answers that you got back. I assume you're just going to go looking up the presentation, which works.
I already printed them just in case I made.
Oh, way to go. So we'll go in that order, Burt's Ball Conservation Fund, Connecticut, yeah?
Okay,
in the order as is down on the agenda. I'm not quite sure.
So I have just a few slides. I'll go through each one quickly, because as Brian said, I'm assuming you have some background in these. And Brian, I'm assuming I'll do each one and then stop the questions.
Please.
And feel free to interrupt along the way, whatever works best for you. I'm just going to give you one quick background. I guess for a combination of reasons, if I could just speculate, we've had more opportunities to buy open space this year, I think, than we've ever had before. Every single one of them is time limited for some reason or other. So we have a bigger sense of urgency than usual. Typically when I come here, one of the questions you all ask is, what are the priorities and what could get put off? And so I'm going to go through a little bit and sort of why I hope none of these get put off. I mean, it's hard to budget reports, but I certainly understand your challenges. So let me walk through each one and try to explain the story behind them. So this first one is a project that is about 125 acres of land. Doug Cole was a developer in town who died under 6-7 years ago. Before he died, he was assembling land to do a large development. Typically, a developer buys one piece of land or two pieces of land. Doug had a vision, so literally for 15 years, he was buying up these pieces of land and reassembling and planning to do a large project. And then he died, and sort of everything changed, and the state is now trying to make sense of all their holdings they had left. Usually when I come before you, I talk about open space in urban areas. It's important to serve neighborhoods, or open space in the outlying areas. It's important for ecological purposes. This is one of the few, if not the only, really valuable ecological piece of land that's totally surrounded by development. There's other valuable pieces of land elsewhere. But this one is an area that, in Northampton, those of you who are from here, I'm not, but the sort of the pre-World War II Northampton was basically along Route 9, you know. Northampton, Bay State, Florence, and Leeds. And then development sort of really shot out in the 1950s and 60s. This was an area which was farmland in World War II, became a lot of ranch houses sort of immediately post-World War II, Farmers Home Administration, Veterans Home Administration things. And this property was sort of, it became an island. It was surrounded by development. It was divided up, that people think would develop, and then, say, Doug Cole reassembled it. It is really ecologically amazingly valuable considering where it is. It's the only bog in the entire city. It is sort of rolling sandy hills with, outside of the bog, rolling sandy hills with oak trees. For those of you know the Cape, it's sort of that, and I'm not an ecologist, so some of you may know better than I do, but it reminds me more of the Cape than anywhere else in the state. Not big sandy knolls, but sort of rolling hills. And so it's a pretty special place. And with that Cape topography, it's very rich in endangered turtles, rare turtles. One who's on the state listed species, one who was on the state list was just delisted because it's recovering, but it's still very rare because the turtles like the same site that they can serve. So pretty special site from that standpoint. It actually has frontage on four different roads, which is nice because one of the things we tried to do is create conservation lands available to as many people as possible that are driving there. So this is frontage on four roads. One of the roads is the edge of the wetlands. So that frontage, frankly, is a little bit illusory. You couldn't really walk onto the property, but the other three are very real. So, my screen is different than this. Oh, but this is good. Okay. So this is what the developer had planned to do. We planned to build a lot of houses on the property. Now, to be clear, this is what he planned to do before he did his due diligence about the turtles. So this is not realistic. I'm not trying to do this as a horror story. This couldn't happen today. A lot of development could occur, a lot more than we're planning. Basically, the homes on the northerly part of this view are totally realistic. The plans on the homes between Woods Road, I don't have a pointer, but you can sort of see them. I can't see them now. So the homes from this point, which is Overlook Drive, all the way down to Burt's Pit. That's all realistic. Oh, thank you. You're welcome. Doesn't work against the screen. Sorry. The homes between Overlook and Burt's Pit Road are all realistic. The homes in the northerly part near Sandy Hill are realistic. The homes in the middle probably wouldn't be because of the turtles that are there. To be very clear, we are not against development of homes. We think it's a really important part of Northampton's mix. We just want them to be in the right places. And so, you know, things that affect the bog and rare turtles are not the right places for us to do. We may be going to those paper copies after all.
No. Oops. All right, here we go. Or not.
So this you can see is a compelling view of why it's an amazing piece of property.
Go back in. New members, we are cursed here with technology issues. We have been forever. And no matter what happens, how hard we try, new screens, new everything. We continue to struggle.
Sorry, did you pass out the paper copy?
I did, yeah.
You did.
And I also have this.
Do you have an extra one to steal from me?
Yes.
All right, so I'm sorry I can't give you the great presentation. Do you want to mess it up like this? So the third view is just, fine as a shelfless version, but the developer spent somewhere around $140,000 to put GPS tags on every turtle they could find. So we know exactly where the turtles are. The developer then died afterwards and never went forward.
When did he die?
5 years ago-ish. Okay. This is Doug Cole, who was a wonderful partner we had on other properties. We have good developers and bad developers. He was definitely sort of one of our heroes in the process. So it probably doesn't show up in the black and white version. It's little dots you see. These are not that many turtles I'm selling. These are tracking turtles. There's one count every month. So we could track the turtles. So we know exactly what fence and what isn't. To develop the property, one would need a permit from the Natural Heritage Program. We have a consultant, the same one the developer hired. So again, we're not making a pitch places where the developer couldn't have built homes anyway. But there's a lot of borderline places. So the area we see all the color, that frankly couldn't be homes anyway. Even if you didn't support this acquisition, you couldn't do homes. But everywhere else, the area there's some color, because natural heritage doesn't stop all development. But there's still, you know, we're in the conservation business, and so there's a lot of other areas that are sensitive. This property has a bog, which is on the right. It has three vernal pools, which are amphibian habitat. It has a lot of wetlands. It has the turtle habitat. So very rich. Most of the property could be developed. Some couldn't. So we're interested in avoiding, I'm afraid, to advance the protest. So we played with a lot of things. This is just so you know the process. We played with, you know, how would a developer approach the property? How would we approach the property differently? The red on this is sort of the more sensitive areas. Did a few different scenarios. I'm not going to spend time on this. But our approach was, what are the places in the property which make sense to develop? We have a goal of preserving a lot of open space in the city. Our current open space plan says 25% of the city should be pristine open space. We're currently about 20%. So we have a goal to get another 5% of the city. But we also have a goal of providing affordable housing, and we have a goal of not buying land that would make lot prices artificially high. We don't want to make it a really expensive city to live in. And so this is a property we got to put to the test. We wanted to say, how do we preserve a majority of the property, 125 acres, we're trying to preserve 114 acres, but how do we carve out some building lots to serve other goals? So we end up with this scheme here on, I'm going to use the cursor. I'm not going to use the cursor, that's what messed it up last time. But on the upper right, there's two lots which the developer is keeping along Stonebridge Pond. At the end of Overlook Drive, there's one lot which is really a bad place for lots. So we eliminated the lots that are horrible places for lots. We kept one as an emergency. So if CPA didn't fund this, or if we didn't get a state grant we're applying for, we would still try to move forward this property. We'd have to do one or two homes in a place where we really don't want to do it. But that's still better than what a developer solution. So we always look at fallbacks when we come, you know, we hope you fund this, we always look at fallbacks when we don't. And in the bottom left, where it says excluded, that's the area we want to put 10 lots. And that, we think, is the correct place for doing lots. So the end, these are two lots the developer will keep. This is the emergency lot that we really don't want to do. It's the wrong place for it, but it's better than nothing. And these are the 10 lots we'd like to develop. The two on the left, the developer's keeping. This is, again, part of the deal we did with the developer. The three on the bottom in the middle, lots 3, 5, and 7, we want to make those affordable housing lots. So that's why part of this request for you is affordable housing. The lots, I'm sorry, I can remember from here. Lots 4, 6, 8, and 9, we want to sell for market rate lots. That's going to bring in some money to make this work. Lot 10 is a little bit unique. Lot 10 we originally wanted to sell, and in the middle of this process, an abutter came forward with a large parcel of land, and he was planning to develop it for one home in a place we didn't think made sense. So we've worked out a swap. We are going to give the developer lot 10. Again, this is all approved. We're going to give the developer lot 10, and we're getting an additional parcel of land that shouldn't be developed. So the developer has one building lot and his current lot. Here you get lot 10, we get his other property. It's about $100,000 trade. in the application says 80,000. As we've done more due diligence, we think that it's about $100,000 trade.
I can't read the street. Which street is
it? So that's Burke's Cut Road.
That's Burke's Cut.
It's about 500 feet east of Woods Road.
Okay.
Wait, how do you get access to lots 4, 6, 8?
So these dash lines here are common driveways. Okay. So we want to minimize driveways off Burke's Cut Road. So everyone will be off common driveways. So lots 1 and 2 will share one common driveway. Lot 3, 4, and 6 will share a common driveway. 5 and 7 a common driveway. 8, 9, and 10 a common driveway. So that minimizes the driveways going to Burke's Cut Road, which is important for traffic safety. The lots in back are, in Northampton prices, the lots in front are sort of entry-level lots. The lots in back are higher end lots, sort of mid-market lots.
So, Wayne, right now there's a considerable part of Burke Pits that's still wooded frontage. So how much of that is this?
About half.
About half of that.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, about half, maybe a little bit. Yeah, pretty close to half. Part of it is, let me show you on this screen. I'm sorry, don't want to trust the person. This is the additional land we're getting from that developer, and then it goes off screen. The extra parcel of land they're swapping for lot 10 goes to about here.
I'm sorry, Jeff, I didn't understand your question.
If you go on Burke Pits right now, there's considerable, I live on Wood Road, FYI.
Okay.
So there's considerable green space, frontage right on the road from the houses that are already there. There's a huge gap.
Yeah.
So the question was, how much of that gap is going to be taken up by this proposal?
Right. So pretty much 50%. I don't know if you happen to remember where transformers are, but right on this curve,
right,
is a power pole of a transformer.
Yes.
So that's sort of my landmark where it is. Again, it's about halfway through on that property.
So what, 8 next to the excluded area is the swamp? Not 8 here, but 8 off the screen is part of the swamp?
It's actually draw. The one that's, oh wait.
Parcel 8, I guess I should say. It's not on that. This one here. That's
so that's the other one we're acquiring. That's right. It has a stream through it, so it has a buildable area in it. But to get to the buildable area, they have to cross the wetlands. It's not good for our scenario. So we're sort of consolidating the development in this area. So.
Are those kind of shared driveways still allowed under the new NFPA?
Yeah.
You can still do that?
Yeah.
Because I know there's some restrictions on making like a fire engine access. I think it's 150.
I don't remember. You know, our standard of zoning, which I know is consistent, is we require pullouts every 100 feet, I think.
Yeah.
So it's a width, but it doesn't meet the standards.
It seems like last year they made it much more stringent, but I don't know, there's qualifiers.
Okay. So. I can check out fire chief on that. My understanding is it does. We can okay. When we do the special permit process, they get circulated for comments, and so sort of, I'm assuming mostly because we haven't heard negative comments that they don't have an issue, but we can confirm that. Exciting, very complicated project. So we need sort of all our ducks in a row for this to work. We hope Habitat takes these lots. Our goal, we've been doing this for 25 years, is to give Habitat enough lots that they never run out of real estate in Northampton. But they can only do so many lots at a time. So we're not sure if they're going to want these lots. We would offer to other other nonprofit housing developers. Our experience is nobody else can make affordable housing work, so I don't think anybody else would want them. Valley CDC has already turned us down, but we go to everyone. I say Habitat is shorthand, but I think the other ones who want it. If Habitat didn't want it, if they're too full, we have 3 other lots we're giving them on the next project we're going to talk about, some lots at State Hospital we're planning to give them, then we would, you know, we know this is missing middle gap. So federal funds are typically paying houses affordable people earning 60% of area median income or 80% of the area median income. The market, people earning 150% can afford it. There's this gap of people who earn more than being able to get subsidized housing, but less than being market rate housing. We would aim for that, and the CPA Act specifically allows you to support that. So it's from up to, Sarah's 120%?
Yeah.
So if we didn't find Habitat, we would just, in essence, sell the lots for a dollar. That subsidy would make them affordable to someone building a market rate house. Our plan, one of the problems we have with small lots is we begin these lots that we think are going to be affordable, and then people build really expensive homes in them. So our plan is to limit the program to the Habitat home. So the homes would be between 1,000 and 1,200 square feet. that would have no garages and no basements, and a maximum of three bedroom houses. So they'd still be modest homes, which is sort of actually, frankly, not Woods Road, which is higher end, but in keeping with all that 50s and 60s ranch houses that were done, that's sort of not an uncommon building pattern. Over the years, people expanded those homes, and I think many of my basements, but so it sort of fits that historical pattern.
So these houses then can only be resold at a cheaper price. There's a limit in how much the price can go up in terms of reselling them.
That's right.
Some kind of a equation that.
So the Habitat model, let me use that, which we're working on Glendale Road, the next project we're in Buckeye, is they build a home which is affordable to someone earning 60% of their income or below. When that person sells, they can sell it at 80% of their income. So the idea is they get some benefit from selling the property, but they can't sell above that and it remains at 80% forever. Now they can still invest, so if the market goes up wildly, they don't necessarily gain from that. But if they put an extra bathroom in, there is a formula for getting that money out. If they build a garage, they don't get it out because we're trying not to have people be overhoused. So it's a nice piece. You know, we grappled for a long time, and this CPA and your predecessors have grappled with this, of we really want to encourage affordable housing within walking distance of bus lines and downtowns, but we also don't want to have rich neighborhoods and poor neighborhoods, so we want to scatter it around. And basically where we've come out is we're trying to create rentals in the urban core area. So we have 120 units on Pleasant Street that are in the process of being developed. That's really the right place for that dense piece. But, you know, people who are earning 80% of median income own cars, not with that much lower car ownership rate than most of us, and they don't necessarily all want to live downtown. So trying to create some scattered site around town is sort of a nice balance from our standpoint. So that's sort of the vision for what we're trying to do here. The numbers are probably too small for you to read here, but you have in your spreadsheet. So I'm going to spend a lot of time on this to say, the deal we have is we're buying a property or the option to buy the property for $550,000. We think it's an incredibly good price. And so going back to the question of why is time important, this is one. We appraise just the open space. So you see that we're valuing for our purposes the open space for this property at $400,000 and the lots at $150,000. We appraise the open space, and the open space appraisal came in at $150,000. So the appraiser thinks the open space is worth $150,000 more than we're paying. The lots, which we haven't appraised, but it's coming in $150,000, and yet we can carve off 8 lots that we're selling. No matter how little we sell the lots for, they're worth more than that. Again, in terms of fallback, if CPA couldn't fund this, and I understand that, we would probably still try to make this work. We wouldn't be able to do the affordable lots. We might have to do that house at the end of Woods Road. So as this is with the affordable lots, we're asking for some CPA money and some cross-subsidy. So the lots we're selling, we're going to get more money than we need, and that money. So in essence, if you're a developer, you're making money by selling lots. We're not trying to make money, so the money we would make as a developer's fee, we're going to plow back in to those affordable lots.
How certain are you of the sale of those lots?
We're pretty certain because we priced them internally we're not in the speculation business. So there are about 90 lots on the market right now. And what property owners do is you put them on the market and you say, I've seen lots sell for this amount, and I'm gonna wait till the price comes to me. And people get it eventually, but they might wait 3 or 4 or 5 years. In our pro forma, we're pricing this on what would an investor pay if we bought all 5 lots or all 6 lots. And they're going to discount because that's the business that they're in, and we're not land speculators. So we hope to get more than that, but we're doing it based on what we think the quick turnaround is for doing that.
If someone came along to buy it and hold it, you take it off your hands.
That's right. It could be an investor, it could be a builder. We've done this a few other times. Limited development projects are really complicated. We do about 1 per year, often with Habitat, but we've done some duplexes where Ryan Road hits Sylvester Road. We've done a few projects with Habitat where we give them 1, 2, up to as far as many 6 units. And again, some go to Habitat, but the market rate lots have gone to a couple different developers, and so we have a sense of where the market is. No questions unknown to the process. One of the things that makes this particularly complicated is that the developer will sell us the entire property. He doesn't care, the landowner, he doesn't care how much we're developing, how much we're preserving, but we have to give him a check all at once. So we have to have this land come together. We had some discussions with the mayor. What if we could do the open space and we couldn't find a lot buyer at the right time? If we, the mayor was totally confident that we have so little money tied up for the lots, he might lend it, he might let us borrow money from a bond that we have to repay. We just had some discussions with Kestrel Land Trust and the same thing. So if we got the value of lots down to about $40,000, that's my magic point. That is so safe that I couldn't find a developer for $40,000. We think we can, in essence, internally borrow. But that's money we would have to pay back.
I think you said that the 51,000 and something would be, if this were funded, that $51,000 of that would be attributable to the affordable housing piece.
I don't remember the number of cans.
So my, given the, where my question was going is, given the constraints on funding and that we have to put $160,000 into the affordable housing reserve to the extent that if this were funded and it doesn't come from that reserve, there's sort of some stranded money, which, you know, round two might right. free up, but it does sort of impose a constraint. So I just wondered how that was calculated, and is there any way, if it would be beneficial, to legitimately increase the amount that was attributable to the affordable housing, community housing?
Yes, it's sort of artificial. There's some distinctions, but because we're doing a cross-subsidy mm-hmm. the piece, mm-hmm. we could, in essence, so that amount, the amount we sell to the extent, the amount we sell those four market rate lots, mm-hmm. the profit we make in those four lots, we could attribute those as either subsidizing the affordable housing or subsidizing the open space. That would be legitimate. So that's sort of a fungible piece. If there's a benefit to move to one account versus the other, we could do that. So nothing else it is. But.
So we could put 160,000 of this 234,000 request into affordable housing.
Correct. And this would certainly be eligible for the affordable housing.
And the rest would be open space, or it would be all affordable housing, is that correct?
Before I tell you exact numbers, I want to look at the spreadsheet a little bit so I don't speak out of turn. There's certainly a big amount of money that's fungible that I could assign either one. I don't want to tell you right now, without spending a little more time looking, exactly what that fungible number is. I could do that within a week.
Yes, that'd be great. That would be helpful.
Okay.
Wayne, you write that you're very optimistic about the about this grant coming in, is that correct?
Yeah, so we've applied for the program's called LAND, used to be called Self-Help. It's the state program for buying open space. We apply almost every year. We've never been turned down, you know, knock on wood and all that. But we've never applied for two acquisitions at the same time. This is a really exciting piece for a lot of ecological reasons. It hits Sarah. Sorry, I was going to talk to you Saturday night. I know it's a competitive year at the state level. A lot of people are applying, but I think this is such an exciting property that they're pretty likely to fund it. The other one is still a good property, and other years they might have funded, but besides being the second one that we're applying for, it doesn't score as well. So,
and that's the Glendale Road.
That's Glendale Road. Still, you know, they might fund both. The asks we have for the state, you look at the number of properties, we're like the only one applying for two projects, which hurts us. If you look at the dollar ask we're doing, it's actually modest. The total maximum state grant is $400,000. We're below $400,000 at both projects. So this one, I'm very optimistic. Glendale Road, I just don't know. I wouldn't want to gamble for that. You know, yeah, how that one's going
to
be.
Is it fair to say that if you didn't get the grant, though, you could still do the deal, but with the same qualifications, you know, you wouldn't do the affordables, and you'd have to do a lot?
That's correct.
We
also, I was in this later, but let me talk about this now for a second. This is a little bit hard. I know you all sometimes ask, do we have fundraising capacity? There's other monies that come in. So we have three big projects before you. We also have six other, I think, really exciting projects in play we didn't have signed documents by the time we had to apply. One reason I don't want to put these forward is I don't want to delay those. So we have some fundraising capacity, no question about it. I'm hoping to use fundraising for some of those other projects. But going back to your question, if you didn't fund anything, we might, more projects would fall by the way. You know, if I couldn't get enough from the affordable housing lots, more would come from that fund.
Fundraising from private donors?
From private donors, right.
And have you done that in the past?
Yes.
And how much has come in?
So far, I think we're at $50,000. And we did a broad campaign, so we're very honest. We've been working on all these projects. We want the ability to move your money to whichever project has the need that's out there. Some people have the right to limit us. So some people say, I want this, you know, I live in this neighborhood, I want this project funded. Some people say, you know, we like all your projects, you get to use how you're going to do it. Out there.
So you've got $50,000 that came in over what period of time?
They came in pretty quick. We did an appeal. We looked, frankly, this was at repeat donors, people who contributed in the past. And so over maybe 2 months after we did a fundraising letter last May or June.
Okay, so it's since spring.
It's since spring.
Uh-huh, okay.
Right, right. But again, you know, we have a lot of projects in play for peak. So I hope that doesn't mean you just reduce, you know, what do we tell? We give people our track record. Because obviously, I hope you don't think I'm manipulating you, but we tell you how your money gets leveraged, and each dollar you give us leverages other people. We do the same thing for donors. And so we tell people, on the average, for every dollar someone contributes, we find $8 somewhere else. So that's what we tell donors, that's true, but you're part of that $8 from somewhere else in the process.
Can you go back to your, I know this was in the open space plan that we looked at a year ago, so you're saying we're at 20% pristine open space, and you want to be at 25%? Is the lot as it is today not counted in that 20%?
Right, we're only counting protected land.
You're talking about city-owned land.
City-owned or permanently protected. So we include Mass Audubon, we include state and federal government.
Nothing that's currently developable.
That's correct. Okay. Land is some permanent preservation, and we don't even include in that, there's some preferential tax treatment, but because someone can always pay off the tax and get it, we don't include that as well. It's land, I should say, of the 21% that's permanently protected, it's not all pristine, so that includes Look Park, that includes Pulaski Park in the piece. So we looked at what's actually, I have a spreadsheet where we track by category. I think it's 17% is pristine, but I can't remember exactly what that number is. So 21% is permanently protected, and some of it's not pristine, still
for
important.
Instance, as you noted earlier, you know, some significant area of this lot is not developable for various reasons. That's not in
that's not
overall yet. Breakdown. Though,
that's
where I stand.
Right.
Then how, I just want to ask about the affordability issue. A lot of the projects we supported have had housing that had been more concentrated and had been then under the supervision of an agency or nonprofit of some sort. And has it also had the, to me, so confusing feature of being extraordinarily expensively developed with enhanced SROs generally costing, I think the last estimate was about $150,000 a piece, which is equivalent to the sort of price of house and lot in parts of the outer area of Northampton. But I hate to think what if we develop housing in that same way, then we would be building a very tiny little house for $500,000, which would make it not affordable. How can the city build an affordable house that is at the same time does not significantly reduce the market value of a lot that's adjacent to it and shared the driveway with it? If it's a tiny, no basement, no garage house with, as a result, cars all over the yard, as is the case in several of the Habitat houses in the community, and we're expecting to put a, you know, Garrison Colonial on the adjacent lot, that's not going to happen. Is that figured in, and how do we keep it affordable, which is, I'd like to see it happen. I've voted for all these projects, but not mess around with the development of that affordable lot. How's that going to happen?
So It sounded like a set of questions. That's exactly what I'd like to talk about. So I'm glad you raised it. So some of you may have been around 2 years ago. We had a surplus lot on the end of Garfield Avenue in Florence. And 2 years ago, we did a design competition. And we said, we're going to create a very small lot. We want to encourage small lots, so that should be an option. But we're worried about crappy homes being designed. We don't want people to think of small houses as being poorly designed. So we actually did a design competition. And we had a design competition. We had took over AP Gallery for a week to do this. We had a Gazette insert. Mm. We had 14 entries. And one of the buyer, the city sold this lot as a surplus lot. The buyer had to hire one of the firms. He hired Dory Brooks. So someone bought it. He ended up not building. He just resold it. The new buyer hired Dory Brooks, who's designing the home. Her design will be done in December. And you see that. But so that was the point there that's really exciting. How do you show a small lot community? Our intention is to do exactly the same thing for this property. So we're planning to do a design competition. We have we're taking over AP Gallery from December 4th to 10th for an exhibition of designing for community health. And the end of this exhibition is announcing the competition. We'll be opening bids next September for the competition. And the goal is, we're calling this one Green Housing for All. They don't want small lots, big ideas. This one's Green Housing for All. And so the success, we're doing design competition, and the idea is, how can you do exactly that? How can you build a small 1,200 square foot house that meets the habitat standard? How can you make it green in terms of architectural design, you know, both attractive and environmentally green, and keep the cost and keep it affordable? So that's exactly what we're planning to do. And then the buyers of those lots building affordable units won't get to build anything. We want them, we're gonna constrain them because it does have to fit in the neighborhood that's out there. So that's built into this process. If you look at the soft costs, there is a bigger soft cost item than typical, because we're including this architecture fees, which wouldn't necessarily be part of a habitat house, but we think that's important for exactly the reason you said. And of course, we have a separate motive. We want, it's important for these homes, but we also want to demonstrate to developers and to neighborhoods that you can build affordable units.
Will the city be the contractor in that case?
Not to build a home, no. We're not in business. So we would sell the home with a deed restriction that requires a home, that's the lot that gets built, that's the sign that gets built.
Affordable. Parts only or for
just the four lots.
So it's right. Just for the three lots?
Just the three lots. Of course, we have the design, so it may or may not inspire the market rate lots. And of course, that's the part that could be funny. If we have the affordable lots, may end up being nicer than the market rate lots, but we're just constrained the ones that we're going to start for.
Well, I think David's asking, when you assess the market rate lots, are you taking into account the fact that there's three tiny affordable housing?
We are, but we think it's less about the tininess. I think it's this fear about how well the design they are. So yes, we're assessing them based on them being small homes, but we're hopefully, mm-hmm. people being sure they're going to be architect design homes, hopefully makes people less nervous. But yes, we've built that in. So when we ask realtors to give us an estimate for what these lots are worth, we disclose exactly what we're trying to do.
There's something about the big project, absolutely necessary to have these highly competent affordable housing agencies in charge because they know how to do it. But there's something about the pass-through for that adds a huge amount of cost. And it's normal and it's statewide and it's industry standard, so it's fine. But it adds a ton of cost. And it seems to me like we have to have a model that doesn't add that cost, that somehow keeps it more at the as the contractor, I mean, if you gave most of the contractors in town $150,000, they could certainly build you a lot more than an enhanced SRO. I was actually hoping that the city was going to be the contractor because somehow it's got to be in a very efficient contracting system that's quick and doesn't have to go through some.
Some
bureaucratic process.
Right. The limits on contracting affects public agencies, you would get a $200,000 SRO. We have to pay prevailing wage, we have to do bidding. So we're very good at knowing what we don't, us doing design, us doing master developer, developing, which what we're doing, doesn't drive up the price, and we think we can beat the private sector. But us actually building things costs more, so that's what we're trying to stay out of a cost as well. But one of the reasons, the reason we chose this for design competition is because there's three lots, and so there's a synergy. You know, builders like do knock off three foundations, knock off three frames, and so there's some benefit for doing it. So we think that we can get the price of housing less in doing that.
And the goal is that Habitat would take these three lots?
Yes, we're absolutely offered to them. They have to decide, being very honest. So the state legislature just passed legislation in July, surplusing some land that was at the state hospital, was originally under the housing authority, that they never moved forward. Three lots in Chapel and one lot of Burstford Road. And Habitat's been clear, that's their first priority, Glendale Road is their second priority, this is their third, and they just need to a projection how far out. One is that we're doing, made this deal more complicated because we want Habitat here. This is maybe more details than you want, but just to mention this. Our original plan was we would give Habitat a grant, and they would buy the land from the developer. We never cash to the city. But Habitat's limit to the number of homes they do isn't actually how many homes they can build. It's that they offer their own mortgages. Habitat doesn't believe in doing interest. They do their own mortgages. They only have a certain amount of capital. There is this federal home loan bank mortgage program that would provide mortgages for end users. You get points if the land is donated to you. So if we gave Habitat money and they bought the land, they probably wouldn't rank out to get the federal home loan mortgage. By buying the land and giving it to Habitat, they hopefully get the money. And that's important because then Habitat's capacity can go up. Instead of building one house a year, they can do two or three houses a year.
What if Habitat couldn't make it work? Do you have a plan B, a proof
to go to? So we offered to every other affordable housing developer. Again, we talked to Valley CDC, who looked at the numbers, and they didn't think they could make it work. So my guess is nobody else would. But that's when we then switch. If we could do an affordable housing developers, houses below 80% of area median income, if we couldn't, we'd be aiming at between 80 and 120%. And so in essence, we could be selling to an individual. So, you know, just an example, Paradise Pond Apartments was built by Wright Builders. And even though these are transitional houses, so people at risk of homelessness, their numbers came in fairly low. Their numbers came in, I'm sure, more than $150,000, but for a house, you know, sort of nicer. Their cost per unit came in. So that's a possibility, just a for-profit developer who wants to build the homes and could crank out the three homes and keep the numbers low. They wouldn't meet that 80% number, that's too low, but they probably could meet the 100, 120%
number. And your lot sizes would be the same, so this is platted out at a particular, with a particular orientation, and whatever happens, it stays that way.
That's right.
Who builds the driveways?
So that's a good question. What we thought about doing with this is debt level detail we haven't quite gotten back to, is creating another internal subsidy, is having the market rate homes build the driveway, and then Habitat homes might get a pass, but we haven't gotten to that level.
So it would kind of restrict your timing, right? I mean, someone has to actually be there to do the market rate homes then for Habitat.
Yeah, but we could sell the land with the restriction that they do it. Again, because if it's Habitat, because Habitat has the order to State Hospital first, then Glendale Road, they're probably not going to actually build the homes for a few years. They would commit to a permanent deed restriction. We know we'd be getting them. But, you know, they would do those other ones.
So the timeline either way.
Right. But again, that just to be clear, that's a level of detail we haven't gotten to. So as we look at the numbers, as we look at what we're really selling for, we can see if we can do that or not. Mm-hmm.
Other comments on this? Jeff, from a housing perspective, anything you want to ask?
No, I'm just familiar with what you were saying with the housing authority lots at Habitat. You know, we just finished up transferring that so the Habitat can get into that. No, I think one of the strengths of this is the three lots for affordable housing. And I was a little worried when I first read this that I understand the importance of the housing units and how that fits in, but I didn't want to have the entire frontage number of pits taken up with more houses.
Right.
You know, it does. So there's still going to be an access into that after the house.
One thing I didn't go over, I guess I should have, I'm sorry, but is, I don't think, yeah, I was skeptical. So we have an open space and recreation and multi-use plans. I talked about the 25% goal. The other thing is, it is a master plan for where we'd like to see our multi-use trail network, think bike paths, 20 years from now. We're not dating when we get there. And one area is extending the bike path that's sometimes called New Haven Northampton Canal Line or the Manhattan Rail Trail, extending that all the way up to Overlook Drive. Actually, all the way up to Sandy Hill and all the way up to Clark Street. Because we want to be basically have someone be able to go from Ryan Road School all the way downtown safely on a bike path. And this property is also a key part of that. It lets us do it. So that frontage area we're talking about, we want to reserve that right to be able to build a trail through.
Yeah, there's an already existing trail, mountain bike trail, running.
That's exactly what we want.
Right there.
And so this could be a 20-year build, but that's the idea, is that spot could someday be, you know, a trail that made sense in the future. Again, you know, we're going to Williamsburg and Hatfield first, but as we have this master plan, so we think these things through where we're going. We already have a right-of-way across Emerson Way and that development. We already have a path that goes through Pathways Co-Housing and Rocky Hill Co-Housing and Ice Pond. And some of you weren't on here, but you guys funded a project between Route 10 and Route 66. A year ago, we bought land there. We're designing a bike path there. So it's all part of that overall scheme that gets back there. And then, Dave, the other thing I comment I should have made, we're very good. The reason those habitat lots are right in the middle is, yes, it may have some effect on the price of the market rate lots, but we'd rather the effect of the habitat lots depress our lots that have existing homes feel like we're bringing a nuisance to the neighborhood. So that the lot, you know, the seven lots that abut this are all part of this development. And the developer we know going forward, and any buyer knows going forward. So it's not like someone will live there for 20 years and say, oh my goodness, there's a habitat home next to me. Not that I think I should worry about that, but at least we're trying to reduce that piece. And we've been consistent on Glendale, on Garfield Avenue, for example. We gave lots of habitat for five homes, and we kept one lot we sold as a market rate house, and that market rate house was the one closest to the landfill. We wanted to send a clear message to the landfill, safe, and we're putting wealthier people closer to the landfill than we're putting poor people, so it's an important part of the message.
Is there any discussion of doing anything other than single family?
We had a little discussion. Valley CDC asked that. In the end, it didn't seem the right place for dense development, and the only affordable housing agency who was interested is Habitat. Habitat used to do condexes, and they've gotten away from that.
Sorry, used to do what?
Condexes, two-unit condos.
Oh, like a duplex.
Like a duplex, right. They've gotten away from that, and so it just seemed like the only people who wanted it. We didn't object, but. Okay, onward.
Other questions? So Wayne, you'll get back to us regarding the ability to switch things around and put 160 of us in affordable housing.
Yes.
Or not, and Sarah, you can communicate with Sarah and she'll share that with us.
I'm sorry, I know you spent a long time, but this is a really complicated project, and I don't want to take up all your time for your reference, but I just want to go back to what you said earlier about if we didn't fund this, you would still do the project.
Well,
can you just talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, I mean,
it makes it sound like we're basically paying, like, whatever it is, 234 to get affordable and to save one lot. Is that about right?
We would have to make other compromises in the deal.
Okay.
So my charge in any project, I mean, obviously I don't want to make it easy for you not to fund me.
Sure.
But let me just say it sort of quick background. So I've been working with the city for 28 years. And typically when people are buying land, they sign an option for the land. And if you guys own your house, you probably need to purchase a sale agreement. You agree to buy and the seller agrees to sell. We don't do that. The seller agrees to sell, agrees to take it off the market for a year to a year and a half and freeze the price no matter what offer someone comes in. So someone says, hey, the city's ripping you off, I give you an extra $50,000. The seller can't sell them. And yet we don't pay for the option. And the reason we get away for that is for 28 years we've never signed an option that we didn't close on. And yet we know, you obviously, I mean, I hope you fund this, but we totally in your right not to fund it, and you may not at some point. So I always do deals and think about what the backup is. And so the backup is a combination of some other deal not happening afterwards. So funding, which I have for another deal, might not happen. So this might still happen because it's our highest priority, mm-hmm. but the one further back wouldn't happen. More houses in the wrong places, less affordable units. So it's a combination of all
this. It's not as simple as just...
It's not as simple, right. And I haven't frankly done... I've got enough to know with a combination of all those things I can make it work. I haven't done the pro forma, so I can't tell you exactly what the switch off will do. So it's a big trade-off for us in terms of the process.
And this is a clear number one priority of all the projects.
Yes, for both. The one is that when I started saying I represent different clients, so you always ask me my priority list, but of course my priority list may be different than my clients. In this case, the Conservation Commission with four acquisitions for them, this is their top priority, and Planning Office, who doesn't necessarily have the same priorities, it's our top priority. Because it meets these different goals, affordable housing, open space, ecological preservation, and a bioprofessional.
Anything else on this project?
Not directly, but on the $160,000, that's for two rounds, right?
Correct. That's for the entire fiscal year. Okay, moving on to, what are we doing? Conservation, is that right?
Yeah.
So let me walk you through this. We're asking for $80,000. Typically, we say we actually don't know what the properties or projects are. This lets us move quickly on properties to come in the door. We've had properties literally which we closed on a month after it came in our door, and the conservation fund has been really useful to let us move forward on those properties. But as I said, that we have so many things in the works, this is different than most years. We have five properties which we're really excited about and want to move forward on, and they would expend far more than $80,000. These are $300,000 of deals in process. And so the Conservation Fund is particularly important to us for opportunities. So let me sort of walk you through them. One is, I like to say that since I've been in Northampton, I've tripled or quadrupled the amount of open space in the city, but I have the number of conservation areas. Because we're trying to merge conservation areas together so they tell a story, so we're creating wildlife corridors, which is part of what we're trying to do. So Mineral Hills, we're trying to create a Mineral Hills that someday extends from the Williamsburg line all the way down to the East Hampton line. It has a lot of gaps, but we're sort of aspirationally moving forward for doing it. The first one is a really exciting piece of property that's about 30 acres, and the second one is additional properties that are next to that, there's an additional 2 acres that would take a big chunk of extending the Mineral Hills. Right now it ends just south of Turkey Hill Road. The Glendale Road property I'm about to talk about is south of Route 66. We have wanted to make a big gap. It would not connect them, but it would sort of shorten the distance between them by about a third or 50%. So really exciting piece of property, still working out some details. The big property, we have an agreement in principle, and I'm sure it's gonna work. The small 2 acre property, we don't have an agreement. We sort of haven't made an offer until we know the big one works. But you know, again, very exciting property that connects, includes a lot of wildlife corridor, includes hopefully walking corridor, which we connect them all. And interestingly, actually includes old lead mines that date back to 1700, which is due diligence in terms of the lead, the mineral that's there. But it's sort of nice, you know, we try to preserve natural areas, but also the human history. And so the first lead mines were hand dug, everyone did this 300 years ago. And the last mines were like 100 years ago, and again, I don't know about technology. There's a lead mine guy, I never knew before, who turned us on to us in the first place. He knew one mine, he gave my GIS guy a tour, who then did what's called LIDAR, which is laser imagery. He did very detailed assessments, and from the total, it's found 3 more mines. You don't really see in the ground until you zoom in. So sort of, you know, an exciting piece, we really want to move forward on that. That one, we have a little bit of time. The seller is not desperate to move forward. So we would have to your next round, except, of course, there may not be another round if you spend all the money now. So that's why the timing's not really good. That's one I need to close on until July, but I probably couldn't put that one off beyond that. Then we also have one that just came in today, I mean, we've been negotiating for 2 years, but just came in today as it's going to happen. If any of you know, the Roberts Hill section of Soma Hills abuts up to Reservoir Road, which is an acquisition with your funding last year, and abuts up to Water Street. And there is a map for that, I think. So it's probably not very easy at this scale, this one. But what you don't see in this whole sort of L-shaped piece is what we own already, and filling in the gap is this one. It's about a 25-acre parcel of land. It will give us frontage on Water Street, and frontage on Reservoir Road, and we try to create as many fingers as possible so people can walk and not need to drive. And it would sort of bring it all together. So again, that's a really important one for us going forward. Very strong support in the neighborhood. They're incredibly excited. It is, unfortunately for my purposes, a modest income neighborhood. So some neighbors we can rely more on fundraising from abutters than others. This one that's unlikely to be a big fundraising piece. And we know this because we just bought a piece of property on Reservoir Road that we did fundraising. And you know, it's one of the most excited neighbors for the project. It was one of my most disappointing fundraising campaigns. Lots of people gave us $25. It wasn't lack of support, but $25 for them is what $1,000 is for some of the neighbors. So I don't anticipate a big fundraising campaign for this.
Before you go on, you said there was frontage on Water Street?
It's frontage on Water Street.
Whereabouts?
So it is maybe 200 feet north of Hotel Bridge.
Okay.
If you happen to know where Jan Williams lives,
yep.
There's a house with a pond in front.
Yeah, yeah.
We'd be buying this from her. Her house would remain.
So it's,
and
the,
it's lots
it's
of
the
light.
23 acres or whatever that's associated with the house?
Okay. That's correct. I think except for 6 acres she's selling to one of the abutters.
Got it.
So it's, I think it's 26 now, it'd be going 20, something like that.
You're talking about this one here?
That's correct.
And this is the on the street. The
that's right.
Folk out place.
Right. And then we have, you don't see it on here because the color isn't good enough. We, when Jonathan Wright developed his Soma Hills project off of Reservoir Road, he gave us easement from Reservoir Road back to the rear of his home. Right now it's a landlocked easement, it doesn't do us any good, but it would tie into that piece.
Mm.
So when we do this, you know, this doesn't go to Reservoir Road, suddenly it activates our access to Reservoir Road. And then we have a couple of smaller properties. There's, if any of you know, Corza, who's in Hatfield. He owns some land, actually on the west side, I'm sorry, the east side of Coles Meadow Road. Most of Broadbrook, Fitzgerald Lake has been the east side. It's a wonderful ridge, it's nice for walking. That's the one that's least certain. I had a handshake agreement with Corza, but that was a month ago, and he hasn't signed the documents yet. So, you know, these things are always in play a little bit. We think it's going to happen. And then a much smaller one on Marion Street that's not a big ticket item. So a lot of things going on. These may shift a little bit. There's still the conservation fund that lets me move money around. But it's why it's sort of important to have these deals that we're going to lose. These we haven't signed because I take this seriously. We don't sign a document until we're sure we can deliver on it. And so we haven't signed these because I, you know, they don't know.
How many of these are under our 20,000 cap that you can spend without?
So Marion Street's the only one that's under, but again, in terms of our fundraising capacity, we would probably do these and then do some fundraising to fill in the gaps for doing these things.
So you would think that you could make do with being under the 20,000 cap for some of these, given other sources of revenue?
So here's where I am now. If you fund, again, I understand you may not, but in my scenario, if you funded everything we're asking for, if the state funded everything we're asking for, then we could do definitely the top three of these properties to fill in the gaps. Those are the three big ticket items. Those are roughly $100,000 each. So between those, we could do them. So a lot of ifs in that state.
This is the $80,000 here for this?
That's correct.
Right.
So you, again, usually we haven't pre-committed. We get the land and we go forward.
Okay.
But this year, because all these are forward, that money would go after it.
Mm-hmm.
What did we do in fiscal year 16, do you remember?
40,000, I think. Is that
what did we do?
it was 48, I remember.
And how about 15?
We skipped a year, so nothing that year.
Nothing in 15.
And before that, it was 50,000, and it was 1 year we got 50,000 both cycles. I can't remember if that was 15 or further back. We have a number that I remember offhand exactly.
I mean, how singular is this, this year? You seem to indicate that this is very unusual.
We've never had so many deals come on. We had a couple, you know, there was a year we did the whole, what became Grove Foods in Northampton and the recreation area. And in terms of dollars, that was a bigger deal. That was $1 million deal. And Turkey Hill Road is $1 million deal, but we were paying more per acre. This is the biggest, both in terms of number of projects and amount of acreage. And frankly, in terms of Glendale Road and Burstfoot Road, North Farms Road, the amount of undervalued properties which we think it did. So, you know, we have two kinds of deadlines. One is the developer might build otherwise, and the other is just our option expires. The seller might be willing to sell to us, we'll put it back on the market. Mm-hmm. And we think developers would be crazy not to buy. We think we have a below market price. We don't pay for the option, but we do share our due diligence. So, you know, we've done surveys, we've done perk tests, we've done some of these things, and so sellers would now discover that they have value they weren't aware of.
Is there, without being too complicated in our thinking, is there a way to think of this as a single entity, as a year of real estate projects that are otherwise going to pass us by?
Yeah, and we would follow your lead, but we had, you know, there was one year in the depths of not the most recent recession, but some other recession, where the mayor asked us to take a year off from doing land acquisitions, and so we didn't buy anything that year. So
where I'm going, I have to ask you about your advice on this because it's a slightly different topic, but is this an entity that's bondable?
Just one time.
Bondable.
Oh, it's bondable. Yes. Yeah, it's certainly bondable. You as a group have tended to be reluctant,
right,
but absolutely it's eligible, and yes.
What?
We could bond. We could advise bonding for anything.
Yeah, this would be easier than some because obviously land, whatever the longest time period you're allowed to bond for, you can do for land.
We're obviously very reluctant to bond for a project, but I'm also trying to see whether this has a singular quality to it that commensurate with the other projects we bonded, or whether this is simply, is this just a slight amount rise in the flow of customer property,
yeah,
is something quite unusual.
Yeah, I think it's an unusual opportunity. The ones we've already gone to council for, not with CPA money, but just in terms of the deals, are both the one on Burstfoot Road and Glendale Road. We had to go twice, once to the open space, and we came back to the affordable housing and lots. Both times we had a unanimous vote, so there's a lot of support in the city council for them. So those two, at least they've weighed in as being unique properties. The other one we haven't gone to council yet, but they sort of got the unique value of these things. And I think one of the councils liked is that we were carving out some lots. We weren't saying we were locking up everything as open space, we were creating some of these lots, both affordable and market.
Anything else on the conservation fund? Okay, moving on to the Connector River Greenway.
So Connector River Greenway, so CPA has been very generous in the past. I want to be clear that both people who helped fund us and people who weren't on the board know that. We've had two rounds before of CPA. Let me sort of tell you where we are and what we're trying to do. So when we did our open space plan in 2008, it came up with 13 actions. One was 25% of the city is pristine open space. One was open space within 15-minute walks of all neighborhoods. Some had to do agriculture, you know, bike paths, other goals. One of those 13 things was creating access to the Connecticut River. So it stood out among other things as one of the top level goals. With your help, so we had a big donation of land. We had Peter Kokok had $50,000 in the state legislature. That money helped us do due diligence and helped us get 13 acres of conservation land. What you all funded, along with a large state grant, was 6 acres, maybe not exactly right, the acreage of recreation land. And we built a park there. We built a ramp down to the water, we built a dock that sticks out, we built a parking lot. Northampton Community Rowing matched us with, I think, $130,000. We got $400,000 from the state, more or less. We got, I don't remember the number from you guys, and we did some other fundraising, and we built, and then Northampton Community Rowing built an additional boathouse without any local money, neighbored of $100,000, I'm not exactly sure, because it didn't come through us. So we've done all that, it's really exciting. We totally comply with Americans with Disabilities Act, and so we have a handicap accessible ramp down to the water. Two things we weren't able to do because the money ran out, you know, it's an expensive process. One is, while we meet ADA standards, we also built a ramp down to the floating docks. ADA standards are usually below 5%. On our docks that go up and down, you're allowed to be steeper. We built this ramp that technically meets ADA, but frankly, it meets the letter of ADA, not the spirit, because no one's going to really want to meet, unless, except when you're in flood, the docks are so low that it's a really steep ramp. So legally, we met ADA, but it's not really accessible. So there's two things we want to do now. One is we want to build a real accessible dock. David sent me some pictures of pre-made docks that do this. So basically, there's a concrete pier that's out there. So if you go down to the water, on the left side is the docks that are primarily used by the rowing, by the high school rowing club. In the middle is the accessible ramp that's down that people use for canoes and kayaks, and it's what makes us legal right now. And on the right is a concrete pier. We want to attach that concrete pier, a floating dock, and a ramp, so we go out fairly far, and then we have a way that someone can come down and load themselves into a canoe or kayak. The water fluctuates a lot, so I don't want to fool you. There will be times in August where the water level is so low that the dock's not going to be above water. But most often during the season, we get, you know, getting away from water, way away from land. So in this year, for example, there's a longer period where water was incredibly low. But generally, we'll be providing handicapped access for most of the time. So that's one thing. The other thing we had to do, this is really unsexy, but we ran out of money and we put, typically you do two courses of 1.5 inches of asphalt. We ran out of money and we did one course of 2-inch asphalt. It means the parking lot and the road looks great, but it's not going to last very long. We may get a decade out of it, but it will fall apart much more. It's a really bad investment. We want to get 30 years out of the pavement structure. And so it's sort of wasting money. We spent most of the cost, and we need a coat of asphalt. And so that's the part we're asking for. When we filed the application, we said this is contingent on getting a federal match, which we thought we'd get. This is not public because they want to do the press release, but we were notified yesterday that we are getting our federal match. So your money, if you choose to give it to us, is matched dollar for dollar.
And that's $90,000?
That's correct. So that's the part we're really trying to get. And this, unfortunately, is not, because this isn't sexy, we don't think it's fundraising capacity. We've already been to the well. You know, we got $130,000 from Northampton Community Rowing. We got, I think, $5,000 directly from our own fundraising. And so we don't, and Northampton Community Rowing has been a wonderful partner, is also doing a lot of their own fundraising as they build out that part of the site.
This is $180,000 for the final paving portion of the project.
For the whole project, so paving and the...
No, it doesn't say that. I mean, in this summary, that's what I was trying to figure out, how that works.
The accessible boat dock is part of that 180.
Yeah, okay. I could see it was inside there, but...
So in the questions, one of you asked for a detailed budget, and so you're seeing a detailed budget. Now, I want to be clear, these are basic engineer's estimates, so we're going to bid every number changes, but you see the breakdown here. You have the questions on what the breakdown. So the estimate is the asphalt is $110,000, which 50% would be CPA and 50% federal. And so you see that. Again, these numbers are a little fungible as we get more details.
You probably wouldn't have reason to know this, but I think that when Community Rowing put in an application for this, they were estimating something like 45,000.
Can you tell the letter? I'm sorry. I apologize.
The previous request, not put in by the city, for this top coat, was much less than this estimate. I'm just looking for some understanding why that.
So they asked us for the number. It would have paved less. So they asked us for what were the top priorities, what was realistic if they weren't bringing the match. So we sort of thought 45,000, you know. $90,000 we're matching is different than $45,000 we're not matching. So that number came from us, and it was the parking lot that had the heaviest traffic. The problem with this grant is now we're sort of either in or not in for doing it. So we've committed, if they give us a grant, then we have to pay everything. So, because you guess the pavement structure down to the water gets less traffic, so it's still at risk, but it would last longer. Yeah. So yeah. Peter Rowan questioned us, and it's what's the absolute minimum they can do.
The $90,000 that came in the grant, congratulations that you were awarded, requires a one-to-one match?
That's right.
So if we didn't get that, we'd have to turn down the $90,000.
Yeah, unless Peter Rowan thought they had fundraising capacity, I think it's unlikely. I know I don't have fundraising capacity.
And you don't think you have fundraising capacity for an accessible dock?
Yeah, it's interesting. I guess I've never done that sort of, I mean, open space, because we've done a lot of, I sort of know who the donors are out there, and because we don't find that many new donors when we do fundraising. I guess I haven't really searched, so I don't know the answer for doing that piece. I know for the grant, I need to match it all. I mean, you know, if the question is, if you funded this but funded it $10,000 less, we would certainly try to fundraise for the dock, or try to fundraise for whatever seems the sexiest in the process. But if I just, I, having not done it, I can't tell you that.
And this is a this dock is something that I've been promoting for years as we've considered the project, and it's a I feel very strongly about it, and strongly that it needs to provide as much independence for people accessing the dock as possible, and not simply rely on beach launching. And I forwarded you some stuff that would allow be much easier, more smoother transfer from chair to kayak.
And they're frankly pre-made, which is a lot easier. So then right. I can custom made. You're
yeah, there's,
great.
There's several companies that make those. Yeah. Centric, for those of you who are unfamiliar with them, these are systems that have gradual. Floating systems with their gradual ramps that go descend into the water, that have handrails that go into the water as well. And the person approaches who's in the water wants to land their kayak or canoe will grab hold of the handrails and then can, because they're rollers underneath, can pull themselves up onto a then stationary position at the level of the dock, dry. Firm and can then easily can with next to a surface where their chair can be, so that they can have complete, you know, relatively unassisted transfer from one form to another, which seems to be like exactly what we want. And then the same that you can just continue on down and go back into the water, so it's sort of up and flat and then down, depending on what it is you're trying to do at that moment. But it's far better than the sort of situation where someone has to be physically carried out of a chair and placed by one or two other people into something on the beach, and these are common. There are a number of companies that make them. I think that not to preclude our discussion, but that it's Northampton really needs to have this kind of stellar insulation, because we should be setting the standard here. Can you do that? Can this include something?
Yeah,
like that?
So the dock is easy. I mean, not easy, but it's just money. And we have that pier, so we've already spent. So we have, if you haven't been down there, there's an asphalt trail that goes all the way out into the water. We invest a lot of money on a parallel concrete path to keep it at ADA standards. So we get you all the way down to this concrete pier. So physically bolting is something that is easy. The reason I gave the warning about the low water level is it's not so much the dock. I mean, I can look up the price, we know what it is. Mm. It's what's the extension, how far out do we have to go? Mm. And that's just a matter of dollars. So yes, we can do it. And this may be a funding issue of, when the water level is really low, we're probably not gonna go far enough out. So the more money we get, the further we can extend it out. So the structure you gave showed some pictures of a connection. But each connection, you pay, you know, money to pieces. So that's really the question: is how far out in the water does it go? We need to, and what I like about these is they need to be light enough that we can pull them in, because we want to make sure these can withstand floodwaters. Mm-hmm. If you see the dock, the deal we worked out with the community rowing is they're responsible for maintaining, and so we worry about during floodwater. We want to pull these out in the spring freshet. So that's the other warning is we would probably not do the docks until Memorial Day. So there's a borderline area where sometimes you got river early.
Yeah, the water too high and bad.
But yeah, so the same time, there's a time period when we have the, my office maintains the channel markers in the river, and we put them in Memorial Day and we take them out on Labor Day. That's sort of the peak time and there's more flooding the other time, so. But given those things, yes.
Is there any, one source of possible fundraising is, there are a number of nonprofits in the area that do access programs. And while they are not probably in a position to donate money to the city, they might well have user fees that are available, or be able to supply user fees for, to help, cover some of the costs annually.
We did look at, Department of Conservation and Recreation has adaptive rowing program, but they're already running it off of their site at Damon Road. So I think sort of their eggs are in that basket and they're committed to that site. And that's, and not that I'm willing to share, but that's sort of where they've been putting their resources.
Mm-hmm. Wayne, what is the 30,000 related site work? What does related site work mean?
There's going to be some grading. Anytime you go out to anything, there's always grading and earth moving, and I'm always stunned by how expensive that stuff is. So it's mostly moving earth. Moving earth.
Moving earth for what?
For whatever we're building. So going into the ramp, you're going to have to move some soil to where you're attaching it. For anything we build, you end up having to move some soil around. So it's sort of a catch-all knowing what to do. We have to do drainage. So, when we raise the pavement structure 1 inch, all the catch basins, some of the catch basins were built as if we had that right asphalt level. There's going to be some alterations to the catch basin, there's going to be some erosion control. So there's just, there's always that stuff out there. We don't leave it out because then we find we're missing something. It's to some extent, the other way of putting this is we typically put a 10% contingency in a project. There's actually no contingency here. That's the equivalent of contingency. That's where we think the stuff comes up.
Any other questions about the Connecticut River Greenway? Okay, moving on to Mineral Hill.
So this is the other limited development project. This is sort of a little further along than the first one I talked about. This is the one that is really nice property, not arguing ecologically, it's quite as rich, but it's a wonderful piece of property. It's 53 acres, I think, 54 acres. It includes everything from the foothills, the Mineral Hills, where the Mineral Hills begin, the western edges abuts an existing conservation area, the ridge unit of Mineral Hills. And it goes all the way down to the part of Barnes Aquifer, which is the largest, I believe the largest aquifer in western Massachusetts. Controversial, some of you know this is why the landfill ended up closing, because it's unclear whether that was part of the aquifer or not, but we, at this point, officially it is part of the Barnes Aquifer. Nice site. There was a developer who for 50 years, frankly, was at the edge of developing the property, came to the planning board a few times for preliminary plans. Let me go up to the next slide. And sort of in a low-key place, but in 2001, actually came before the planning board to do a formal subdivision. So when you do the low-end plans, they spend a few thousand dollars. This is up, $150,000 worth of work. So the developer was very serious about doing this. So the property clearly could be developed for 24 units. It has all the permits in place. It would have kept some land as open space, but it really divided the valuable open space. The neighborhood hated it. It would create a lot of cut-through traffic. So I think next slide. We approached and said, yeah, you could in theory do that kind of project. Frankly, the market's not likely to support it. There's a reason developers not going forward. Roads are coming in at $400 to $500 a foot, and it's hard to make it play. This is a more likely scenario a developer might do. Not a horrible scenario, but 7 homes, not necessarily the right place. Some water pressure issues, some wetlands issues, some dividing of area. And so not really a good scenario for us. Okay, next slide. Lots of wetlands we're trying to protect. Lots of upland habitat, also turtle habitat here. Some really valuable things. So what we're trying to do is basically all that land is together. Is one lot, it's what we're trying to preserve. It is frontage on West Hampton Road, it is frontage on Glendale Road. And then we're gonna carve out 4 lots. So there's one lot just north of sort of that hammerhead. Next slide, sir. Go back.
Got it showed on the
Yeah, so you see, so maybe, yeah. So the biggest, just north of this, is three lots on a thin driveway, a common driveway, and one lot on Glendale Road itself. So we want to carve out four lots. These lots we're going to give for Habitat for Humanity. So this is the reason that Burst Pit Road is in the top priority. They want these four lots that are out there. Next slide, please.
I'm sorry, they're prioritizing these four over Burst Pit.
Correct.
And why is that?
Easier site work, better soil. So this requires a septic system, which is a challenge. They don't love the septic system, but the soil is actually really good and well drained. Burst Pit Road is definitely buildable. There's no wetlands nearby, but it's, you know, difficult soil for doing. So Habitat thinks this fit works well in their model. They can get someone to build a foundation easily in sandy soil. You can dig with a hand shovel, not that they do it that way, but, you know, easy soil to move around, easy to develop this site. So next slide, sir. So this, again, we're not asking for money for this one for the affordable housing, but it's part of a package deal. So this one, we have an agreement to buy this property for $450,000. We are tapping community development block grant for mayor's approval, and $200,000 will buy these four lots. So the same thing, we want the land to come to the city so Habitat can be eligible for Federal Home Loan Bank. So we're buying this land for $200,000, and then literally 30 seconds later, we give it to Habitat for them doing four lots. Our deal with the seller is $450,000. He doesn't care where the money comes from. So $250,000 will buy these four lots. $200,000 will buy these four lots. $250,000 will buy the open space. So we're only asking you money for open space, but it still helps make these things happen. You know, we can't do part of the deal without the other part of the deal. So our money's firm. So there's three main sources of money for this. The $200,000 community development block grant, which we already have, the money we're asking for from you, and the land grant. We don't have a land grant. We're optimistic, but this is the one, if I'm nervous about a land grant, this is the one I'm far more nervous about than the other one.
And this is the, if the land grant comes in, we wouldn't be 265, we'd be 106. Mm-hmm. Is that correct?
That's correct, yes. 106,372.
And land grant is generally November.
Yes. Last 2 years have been a little slower. Traditionally, in election years, they almost by election day. And in non-election years, they took longer. And last year, I mean, 2 years ago, it wasn't announced until January. Last year, it was December. But used to always be October and November. I'm hoping that we're going to know before you have to vote. Next slide, sir. So again, just in terms of context, you see the center is the land we're buying. You see the lots on here. You can see the land to the west that we already abut, which is, again, we've been calling it the Ridge Conservation Area. We're renaming it the Ridge Unit of Mineral Hills. And you can see the trails. That trail, not all of it, much of that trail already exists. The land on the ridge, the trail on the ridge already exists. The wetlands crossing already exists, some we have to build. And like the Burst Pit Road one, this is in our master plan someday for a bike path. This is years out. So our goal, if we bought the property, would be immediately develop a walking trail, and maybe 20 years from now, we build a bike path, maybe not. At least we're clearly going to reserve the right to do it. Conservation, when we buy land with CPA money, we have to put a conservation restriction on it that further protects it. The conservation restriction will allow a bike path, so at least we'll leave the options open. And our goal is eventually to connect that bike path all the way through downtown, and the master plan sort of shows two routes to get that way. And then last slide. And so then just the budget for this piece going through. Again, you know, the lot sales is sort of, that's the guarantee piece. It says lot sales, but that's technically what it is, but it's an internal lot sale. So we're, you know, that's community on block grant that's paying for the affordable housing lots.
So I was interested in that, in the response to some of the questions, that for the first time ever there is a coordinator position to do trail work and management that the city is committing to, is that correct?
Yeah, it's in the mayor's budget. It actually began July 1st. We haven't been able to hire yet as we go through the process of writing jobs. You know, first time positions always take longer. But the money's in the mayor's position as soon as the personnel does that work.
And what would this person do?
So we have a lot of volunteers who do wonderful work in conservation land. Some groups are really active. Broadbrook Coalition by far is the most active group. And Broadbrook's great because they both do work and actually even care what the projects are. But a lot of people we get are sort of, we can call people up and they swing a hammer, but they won't help plan everything. So we need sort of three or four different things. We need someone who works with neighborhood groups and helps coordinate all those efforts to get volunteers. You know, I spent a lot of work. You guys helped fund the boardwalk at Broadbrook, I mean, at Fitzgerald Lake. That was a grant to Broadbrook. They were all set to do it. They don't understand public procurement, which I understand, it's not a criticism. And they end up turning it to us and say, can we do the procurement because it's really complicated. I don't have hours in my schedule. So that's the sort of thing I want to give to this person. We built a $500,000 bike path extension in Leeds with some CPA money, mostly federal money going in. And you really want to be able to count every truck going through because you pay the contractor so many dollars per yard of concrete or asphalt. And so the more you can monitor it, so it doesn't take a high-end person to be able to monitor construction, but it saves us a lot of money. We had some wetlands violations, frankly, from our contractor, Connect River Greenway. We would like someone to be there. So one thing is sort of be a clerk of the works for projects, to watch projects. One is to work with neighbor groups, and one is to actually do maintenance for projects. Some projects are just easier to do ourselves than to get volunteers. And then the fourth one, which I guess goes with that, is we've sort of been professionalizing our work. And so with your support, we're now surveying every conservation land. Whenever we buy land, we're surveying it. We're going back in time to land we didn't survey in the past. The first time the markers get done by a surveyor, very accurate blazes. If we don't keep it up every 3 years, then someday we're spending a lot of money to get a surveyor back there. And now we've been doing survey markers. I want to send someone through every 3 years because it doesn't take a lot of skills to reblaze. So it's an entry-level position. It's a technician job, but it's things that we can move out there and get a lot of those things done.
And you feel it's not just me or the one-year-and-done thing, but it will be...
Yeah, I mean, you know, obviously there's a big recession, no guarantee, but my office hasn't, we've lost a position with the recession, we haven't gained it back, we're only asking for a half-time position at a lower level, and we now manage or monitor, we also will be monitoring private property, we hold restrictions, we're now monitoring about 18% of the city, so it's a pretty inexpensive, I mean, given that it's a pretty inexpensive position, so the mayor seems to be very committed now. Some new mayor could always do something here.
Other questions about Mineral Hill? You're done with us on that?
Yep, unless you're not.
Last but not least, Broadbrook.
So this is also really exciting. This one's in some ways symbolically exciting and one, you know, for recreation is particularly important. So you can sort of see how it's partially off this map. Broadbrook is a big loop. So the upper left, that green property, that property is called Broadbrook Beaverbrook. And it's literally the watersheds. The headwaters of Broadbrook is where Broadbrook gets born. And it's not the headwaters of Beaverbrook, although it's close to the headwaters. And then Broadbrook comes all the way south through the next piece of green is the land we bought from the Girl Scouts. Then even though it's not green, it goes to the Smith's Occasional Forestry property. Then it goes to JFK property. It's not green, but it's obviously city. And then it comes back into Broadbrook, Fitzgerald Lake Greenway. And so it's this huge loop. And a lot of wildlife follows the stream, so we've been protecting more and more. There's some gaps, but some of those gaps are partially protected anyway by things like Smith Oak. But we've always wanted to connect between the two, because we know that while little critters go along water bodies, you know, larger animals, off, you know, what we call charismatic species, the moose, you know, go cross country. And so we'd like to connect them. And of course, we want to connect for recreation. That land in green is what the city owns in fee, permanent protection. The land in orange is conservation restrictions. That is, there's no public access, but it's permanent protected. It can never be developed. The land in, I'm not going to call it dark green, where the red arrow is pointing. That's the property we're focused on. One of the questions is, does it connect to North Farms Road? It does. Next slide, sir. So it's very thin. So that's why it's hard to see unless you really zoom in. But at that neck, it's still 50 feet wide, 40 feet wide. It's partially the scale. It's a big place. It's actually a wide neck in urban areas. It's a small neck. So it's great for from a recreation standpoint. You know, so it really lets you get in from one conservation, or part of the link to getting from one conservation area to the other conservation. And this one's also undervalued. So the owner is selling it to us for a little bit high for backland. And I think, frankly, it's because they didn't realize it was a building lot. So it doesn't meet the current zoning, which is why they thought they couldn't do a house, but it's grandfathered. It's been in separate ownership. So in order to build a lot, you either need to be in meeting zoning requirement, or you have to have at least 5,000 square feet of land that's been in separate ownership since the zoning changed to make it not a building lot. And this has been in separate ownership for that time period. So that's why we think, that's why we'd like to move on this one as well. Ecologically, it's a nice piece of property, but I would certainly refer to it, it's not as valuable as the other two. But again, recreation, opportunity, it's really important. The large piece of property owned to the west, this gorgeous piece of property, there's a stream, Beaver Brook, close to Haydenville Road. So there's actually not a lot of access from Haydenville Road. We want to build a bridge across it someday. The main way people get to the main property is actually a snowmobile trail, which runs north-south. But we want to, you know, let people in this direction.
Is there any conceivable way that eventually it will be able to connect up with
us? Yes, we're hoping so. So, you want to go back a slide, Sarah? So, the land just to the east of that orange is some land we bought from the Volinger family just last year. So, it used to be a gap in the Fitzgerald Lake property. We bought that from Volinger. All the land to the south of that green property, and frankly the south of the orange property, is owned by the Volinger family. This will be a huge project if it ever comes through. They're clear they don't want to sell it. They're willing to entertain a conservation restriction, basically permanently protecting it as open space, which they would then keep farming. We've gotten far enough along, we're working with Kester on this, that we're going ahead and doing an appraisal. So we're in discussion phases, nothing signed. This will not be for a year or longer. But it's just on top of them.
Everything below all of the, you just designate what you're talking about.
Yeah. Can I point to this screen? So, Volinger owns on the right side of the road is everything from the yellow down to where Fitzgerald Lake sticks out. Mm-hmm. On this side of the road, it's about the equivalent of that property to the south again. And then there's other properties. So Gary Warner, for example, owns a property which reflects the Girl Scouts. And we've been in discussions. He hasn't been able to, he approached us, he has an interest. It hasn't been a top priority. He's interested in selling it at some point. So we're working our way up, trying to get a thin strip, basically along the Broad Brook, property by property. And so at some point, we think we'll connect at least that valley along Broad Brook. Maybe not wider, but that whole connection. There's, some of you may know, and I'm going to forget his name, Robert, but I forgot his name, who is a virgin tree expert.
Leverett.
So he lives right down here. He's been really interested. He thinks that some of the biggest trees in the state is this area right over here. He's worked informally with Smith Oak to try to convince them to log up here, but not to log down here because they're amazing trees. And that's sort of, again, part of the story of connecting along the valley. So it's certainly in our list. Most of, you know, we do prioritize on what's going somewhere. So land that doesn't have frontage isn't really at risk. So it's on our list, but frankly, it's not going to be developing.
So there's one item that wasn't on this, which is this rehabilitation of a 6-acre portion in Beaver Brook, and it was going to do passive recreation, et cetera. Where does that fit exactly into what's already there?
So that's from, you can see Broad Brook Coalition's coming before you, Jeff.
Yeah.
So we weren't the lead for that.
Yeah, no.
The land between the...
but just on there, it's right up in there, isn't it?
Yeah. Sorry, you're gonna, yeah.
Okay.
Right. So you see Beaver Brook itself, which is this very braided
right.
stream, so it's very wide.
Right.
And between the brook and the road, it's a lot of invasives. When we bought the property, we tore down two homes. We had to sell it, tear down two homes for us. Mm-hmm. So until not that long ago, there were two homes, there were driveways.
Yeah, yeah.
And so that's the area.
Yeah, that's what I thought. That's what I was just trying to.
So everyone remember on our cover sheet for this, it should be 58,000 as a total budget. And the CPA funding request is 40,000 rather than the 164 and 69.
Is that
it?
Oh,
recorded.
So on the cover sheet, and Wayne, correct me if I'm wrong on this, the total budget for the project is $58,000, and the CPA request is $40,000.
That's correct.
I see that's with the backup.
Yeah, and so if you go back, it's been consistent.
We just saved you on that mic.
Can you do that for the other one?
Any additional comments from you, Wayne, on this?
I guess just for newer members, I really, you know, I know I'm pushing saying all these are time critical and I hope you fund them all. Just for comparison, I have in other years, I come before you and say clearly, like the first time we came for Connecticut Greenway, where we said this really isn't time critical, put it off if you need to. So, so you know, I don't exaggerate when it comes to time critical.
Any other questions for Wayne while we have him? Thank you so much for your time. We appreciate your energy on behalf of the city. My quick little informal calculations is that Wayne's come to us with $719,700. Well, $720,000. I don't know if it's late. I don't know if my math is right. But $720,000 out of the $912,000 total. So that's a lot coming from this. A lot of requests from Wayne this time. And other than these big projects that we funded in the past, again, I don't think we've ever seen so many projects come from him for land acquisition.
Not all at once.
We've had single ones that have been bigger, but not been quite like this.
Given the complexity of some of these deals, he's a very busy guy.
He is, as is Sarah. So, thank you, Wayne. No longer here to thank, but thank you, Wayne, anyway. The last item on the agenda is any other business. And Sarah, we did have something.
Site visits,
right. So we'd like to go ahead and schedule those. If folks have their calendars. New folks, we try to get to as many sites as possible. There are some that really the only time we can get staff or someone there is during these scheduled site visits. I think we're allowed to, at least on our own, look them up, but it's certainly nicer fun to go. Sarah, do you have dates, possible dates?
It depends on committee availability. Most of the applicants said they can make things work if necessary.
Okay.
David? Can I ask? David, are you planning on attending the thing on the 14th? Because I'm thinking that's a site visit.
Yeah. I think that'd be a nice.
So what applications would be beneficial to the organized site visits for?
Well, would it be appropriate for any of any of the four, obviously not the conservation fund, but any of these four, let's take the 14th out and hope that we can make that 4 o'clock event on the 14th of Connecticut River Greenway. Would this Beaverbrook one, would the Bogs and Turtles one, and the Broadbrook, is that something we'd be able to get access to, Sarah? Are there trails there? Would any of that work?
Sure, at least a little bit of it, anyway.
Okay. And then the courthouse restoration, Smith Charities would also work. And then the Broadbrook renovation one would fit, or restoration would fit into those others as well. Do you want to send us, rather than doing this now, do you want to send us possible dates? Would that work?
I can send out a poll, but give me a sense.
You want to try to do a Saturday again for this? I think we've done Saturday.
Would we try and knock them all off?
One starting at 10 and move right on up. What we've done in the past. So do you want to send this little poll thing on Saturdays? Yes?
Okay. Yeah, so charities, just if it doesn't work out, but they're very good about just letting folks
They're open business hours.
I saw them before and they just show you around. They're nice.
Yeah. Okay, so Sarah will send us a Saturday, a Saturday thing, that we will get back to her as soon as possible.
And mornings, afternoon?
I think generally start at 10 or something, gone through 1 or 2 or 3, depending on things, right? Yeah, and again, there's not pressure to go, we can go on our own, but knowing that staff...
If we could get exact Google Maps address for those who can't make a certain date.
Yeah, I think it is.
So that, you know, if we can't make that, the visit date, I'd like to know, you know, some of these are kind of just real estate, and I wouldn't know exactly where to go to look at it.
Williams might, if it's not an organized site visit, I think it's going to be a drive-by, like look behind house number, whatever.
Okay, something like that, just so that, yeah, there's some sort of landmark that we can use to...
Okay, sure, I can do that.
Yeah.
So just generally speaking, assuming for the moment that we spend all 900 and change this go-round, what happens? That's it? There is no second round?
There is, well, we have 8,000 or something.
Okay.
Yeah.
Have we ever done that before?
Or we could decide, we could make a decision not to even entertain projects for the next round.
Right.
One, I obviously alluded to another option.
Which is bonding.
Which is to bundle and bond.
Going to head there, I was headed there next.
It's all right.
That's all right, no. Just, because I, you know, being new to this, I want to know what are our overall options are.
There's no requirement to have two bonding rounds. If the committee wants to spend everything down to the penny this round, that's totally fine.
And Sarah has shared with us other communities who are so bonded out that they don't meet for years. I mean, they bonded everything out and, you know, just things are going out and they'll meet back in 2023.
I'm reluctant to go that way, but I don't think it does our community a service to tell them that they can't spend CPA funds, that they're contributing to the fund into perpetuity or for an extended period of time. So that's not necessarily the conversation for right now, but I don't see myself going that way.
What I will say, if I can just jump into this, is that if we did do bonding, I would tell Wayne that to come back during the second round. In other words, we need to have room. We would be bonding in order to have some space to accept the second round applications. And I really wouldn't want to bond something simply because Wayne came in with a whole bunch of applications. Ground. This would have to be, that's why I asked the question about exceptionality. This would have to be bonding if it's a really unusual collection of opportunities that aren't going to be available otherwise and that are unlikely to be replicated. So, I wouldn't want a bond just to handle with part of a normal flow of wish lists.
Other general comments? One thing I noticed that we don't interrupt each other nearly as much as the vice presidential candidates are. So from now on, if we could liven things up and talk over each other.
You watch that?
As much as possible.
Who's doing the fact checking?
That would be good. Television viewers, of which there are huge amounts. Any other additional business? Is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Thank you very much.
Well, see you.